From PRI, Public Radio International, it's To the Best of Our Knowledge. I'm Jim Fleming.
You've just listened to some of the sounds of Fantastic Voyage, 20th Century Fox's new movie about scientists reduced to the size of microbes and sent through a man.
Fantastic Voyage? Marvelous. Fantastic Voyage? A marvelous film.
See it, and you'll have a fantastic voyage.
Don't miss it.
Space is the final frontier, but is science fiction the final frontier when it comes to being a literature of ideas? We'll pose that question to two of science fiction's greatest writers, George R.R. Martin and Ursula K. Le Guin. Also today, we'll explore the seven beauties of science fiction and the strange literary universe of H.P. Lovecraft. George R.R. Martin is a giant in the field of fantasy literature. Time magazine calls him the American Tolkien. Martin may be best known for his ongoing epic fantasy series, A Song of Ice and Fire, but he's also written lots of science fiction and horror stories, and he's won Hugo, Nebula, and Bram Stoker awards. Much of Martin's fiction has been gathered in two volumes of a career-spanning collection called Dream Songs. So Martin is one of the best people to ask about Clive Thompson's Wired magazine essay, the one in which Thompson wrote, "If you want to read books that tackle profound philosophical questions, then the best and perhaps only place to turn these days is sci-fi. Science fiction is the last great literature of ideas." Does George R.R. Martin agree that science fiction is the last great literature of ideas?
No, I really don't. I did read the essay, and, you know, he was essentially restating something that science fiction fans have been saying for years, in fact, decades. This idea of science fiction as a literature of ideas has long been something that science fiction fans and, to a certain extent, science fiction writers have used almost as a justification for the literature. I think it's almost a defensive pose because science fiction and, like all genre literature, frequently finds itself put down by, the advocates of mainstream fiction, literary fiction, what have you. But to my mind, all literature contains ideas. I mean, to say that ideas are the exclusive province of science fiction has always struck me as sort of silly. I mean, there are ideas in Tolstoy, there are ideas in Dickens, there are ideas in The Great Gatsby, there are ideas in contemporary mainstream fiction as well as other genres. There are plenty of ideas in westerns and mystery novels and romances. Now, some of them may be good ideas and some of them may be bad ideas, but there's certainly ideas. You can hardly write a story without conveying some ideas.
I wonder if it isn't that people feel often that science fiction and fantasy provides more room for the imagination. There are fewer strictures on you. There are things that you can do that you can't do in serious literature.
If that's true, it's a sort of a sad commentary on serious literature, but I'm not sure that it is true. I mean, I think a lot of the practitioners of what I would prefer to call literary fiction, and with quote marks around the literary, are borrowing a lot of ideas from science fiction and fantasy. You see a lot of this in some contemporary books like Cormac McCarthy's The Road, which is a science fiction book by my standards, but of course is not considered as such by fans of, I guess, serious literature, literary fiction, call it what you will. Margaret Atwood, there was some controversy about does she or does she not write science fiction. She does write science fiction. So we live in a science fiction world. I mean, the crazy ideas of science fiction that came up in the 40s and 50s, and even before that, to a certain extent, you can go all the way back to Jules Verne and H.G. Wells, have now become common currency for all fiction and indeed are part of our everyday lives.
This is a good thing in many ways, it seems to me, because what it's done is to expand the room in which you write.
Yes, yes. But, you know, I mean, the thing that troubles me is classing serious literature as something apart from science fiction and fantasy. I mean, I think science fiction and fantasy are also literature. Yeah. It always annoys me when I go into a bookstore and find a section marked literature, as if this was something separate and apart from the novels to be found in the genre sections. They're all stories. The furniture may vary, but they're still all stories, and some are good and some are bad and some have good parts but are flawed, but they're all basically doing the same thing.
I've heard you talk about this before. I've read about it. There's something you call the furniture rule, isn't there?
Yeah, the furniture theory. This is something that I believe science fiction and fantasy. I've written both science fiction and fantasy during my own career. I've also written horror. When I was a kid growing up in Bayonne, New Jersey, many a decade ago, I read all of these things as a kid. I read Robert A. Heinlein, and the next day I might read H.P. Lovecraft, and the day after that I might read J.R.R. Tolkien. And it never occurred to me that I was reading three different genres, that I was reading three different things. It all seemed to me to be different flavors of the same thing. And my father certainly agreed with that. He would call all these sorts of imaginative literature that I liked, he would call them weird stuff. So I take all these genres and I put them in the weird stuff barrel, maybe as a result of that. And I've always moved easily from one to another, and I've mixed them throughout my career with stories like Sand Kings and Night Flyers, and even to a certain extent with Fever Dream and my current series, A Song of Ice and Fire. They borrow from all of these genres and indeed from some of the tropes of mystery fiction, or the epic tales of bygone centuries, and so-called serious literature.
You know, what's interesting to me in a way is that you, I think, quite legitimately complain about the classification of literature. But within it, there's often some contention. The writers of fantasy and science fiction often say they don't want to be put anywhere near the horror books. Is it just that everybody feels a little as though they're not being taken seriously?
That's certainly part of it. I don't know if it's all of it, but it's certainly part of it. And this genrefication is becoming more and more rigid. Of course, I'm 60 years old, and I come from a time where at least science fiction and fantasy and horror writers did move easily from one to another. That's not so true for new writers breaking in. When I was young, when I was just breaking into the field in the 70s, science fiction was much more popular than fantasy. Today, the reverse is true. And there are some science fiction writers who seem threatened by this and drawing these hard distinctions between science fiction and fantasy and saying that they're two totally opposite things. I don't think they are totally opposite things, and that's where my furniture rule comes in, is I think they're basically the same thing, and what varies is the furniture. You know, you have an elf in one and an alien in another. Both of them perform the same literary function as a trope of the respective genres. They're both the outsider figure dressed up in different clothing.
In your collection, Dream Songs, there's an essay in which you talk about the furniture rule, that in fact, I think it supports what you're saying as something that would be taken by someone like Faulkner. In fact, you quote Faulkner as saying that literature is just a good story, something like that.
Well, yes, Faulkner's Nobel Prize acceptance speech was something that I frequently quoted. He said, the human heart in conflict with itself is the only thing worth writing about. And, you know, that certainly is the philosophy that informs my own fiction. It doesn't matter if you're telling a story set in an imaginary medieval kingdom or in a distant planet 10,000 years in the future, or something set in the suburbs of Chicago or indeed Madison, Wisconsin. The story is still about the human heart in conflict with itself.
I want to ask you about your award-winning series of epic fantasy novels, A Song of Ice and Fire. You created several different religions for this series. Could you have done that if you were writing traditional literary fiction?
Well, I don't know. That's an interesting question. You know, in creating a fantasy world, I think you need to create religions, particularly a medieval world. One of my goals when I started writing A Song of Ice and Fire was to blend some of the feeling of fantasy in the Tolkien tradition with some of the feel of historical fiction, which I also read a lot of. And, of course, if you study the real Middle Ages, the position of the church and the role of religion in inspiring many of the wars and conflicts of the area, whether it was Protestants against Catholics or the Crusades against Islam or the Cathar Crusade against the Albigensian heretics. Religion was very, very important, and I felt it was something that you couldn't necessarily leave out of any sort of medieval setting without really losing the truth of what some of these things were about. So I did that. But I've also included in my science fiction, thousands of years in the future, I've created some religions. And I think man's quest for understanding of the universe is a very fundamental thing. And, you know, why are we here? And what's the purpose of all this? And who put us here? And we're going to probably continue to grope with these questions, whether in the distant past or 10,000 years in the future or in a contemporary novel. I think that kind of spiritual quest, at least, if not formal religion, is part of all literature.
Where do you think science fiction is going?
Well, science fiction is actually struggling right now. I mean, commercially, it's not nearly as popular as it was.
Do you suppose that's because real science is developing so rapidly?
I don't think it's because of the development of science, but I do think there are social factors involved in it. Some of this almost has to do with, again, getting back to my furniture rule. You know, many years ago when I was in grade school, I had a teacher who would, a geography teacher, and she would open these books and say, you know, today we're going to Africa. And then we would read the geography book about Africa. And some of the kids made fun of her, but I think there's an element of truth to that. A good book does transport you to other times and other places and other lives. You get to live other lives vicariously by identifying with the characters in these things. And what happened, I think, the social changes of the last 50 years has made the future something that we no longer want to go visit the way we did when I was a kid. I mean, back in the 50s and 60s, when science fiction was perhaps as popular as it had ever been, we really had a lot of belief in the future. I mean, we couldn't wait to get to the future. The future was going to be much better than anything in the present. You know, we were going to have robots and flying cars and all these labor-saving devices, and we were going to take our holidays on the moon and space stations, and we were going to go to the stars. When they took polls, everybody gave the answer, yes, yes, my kids are going to have a better life than I do, and my grandkids are going to have an even better life than they do, and we're going to go into space and we're going to go into the stars. Well, some of that came true, but also things happened to change that. I mean, we went to the moon, and then we stopped going. I mean, that still boggles most science fiction writers and readers of my generation to think we stopped going to the moon. There are kids, well, they're not kids anymore. They're grown adults today who've never had a man on the moon in their lifetimes because they were born after 1972, which was the last trip. You know, I grew up thinking, will I live long enough to see a man on the moon? And for these people, it's history, and it's maybe a closed chapter of history. I mean, are we ever going to go to Mars? Are we ever going to go to stars? Also, people take polls now, and most people think that their children are not going to have better lives than they do. They think that their children are going to have worse lives. They're worried about things like ecological problems, global warming, the growing instability of the world with nuclear proliferation, more and more nations having to bomb and all that. I mean, we had the Cold War when I was growing up. We did duck and cover and stuff like that. But there was still, in some ways, more optimism about what the future was like. So I think this is part of the stuff that's affected science fiction, that people no longer believe in some level that the future is going to be a good place, and they prefer to read about other times and other places that are maybe not so scary as science fiction.
George R. R. Martin is an award-winning horror, fantasy, and science fiction author. Martin hopes to finish A Dance of Dragons, the fifth volume of his best-selling series A Song of Ice and Fire, soon. Well, we continue to eagerly await that. We can enjoy the two volumes of Dream Songs, his career-spanning collection. Dream Songs also features commentaries by Martin. From the audiobook CD of Volume 1 of Dream Songs, here is George R. R. Martin reading an excerpt from one of his commentaries.
Why do I love fantasy? Let me answer that with a piece I wrote in 1996 to accompany my portrait in Patty Perret's book of photographs, The Faces of Fantasy. The best fantasy is written in the language of dreams. It is alive as dreams are alive, more real than real, for a moment at least, that long magic moment before we wake. Fantasy is silver and scarlet, indigo and azure, obsidian veined with gold and lapis lazuli. Reality is plywood and plastic, done up in mud brown and olive drab. Fantasy tastes of habaneros and honey, cinnamon and cloves, rare red meat and wines as sweet as summer. Reality is beans and tofu and ashes at the end. Reality is the strip malls of Burbank, the smokestacks of Cleveland, the parking garage in Newark. Fantasy is the towers of Minas Tirith, the ancient stones of Gormenghast, the halls of Camelot. Fantasy flies on the wings of Icarus, reality on Southwest Airlines. Why do our dreams become so much smaller when they finally come true? We read fantasy to find the colors again, I think, to taste strong spices and hear the song the sirens sang. There's something old and true in fantasy that speaks to something deep within us, to the child who dreamt that one day he would hunt the forests of the night and feast beneath the hollow hills and find a love to last forever somewhere south of Oz and north of Shangri-La. They can keep their heaven. When I die, I'd sooner go to Middle-earth.
George R. R. Martin with an excerpt from one of the commentaries in Volume 1 of his Dream Songs collection. Ursula K. Le Guin is the author of many short stories, essays, volumes of poetry, and novels. Much of her work is in the fantasy and science fiction genres. Le Guin's awards include a National Book Award and 5 Hugo and 5 Nebula Awards. Steve Paulson was curious to get Le Guin's reaction to Clive Thompson's Wired magazine essay, in which Thompson argues that science fiction is the last great literature of ideas. Does Le Guin think that's true?
Maybe it was the first great literature of ideas. What other literature of ideas is there? Maybe it's a fiction of ideas, because I suppose philosophy is a literature of ideas. But I don't mean to quibble with terms, but I'm not quite sure what he means.
I think what he's saying is that science fiction is sort of this one genre where ideas are taken very seriously. And, you know, quote, literary fiction, normally, you know, it's about sort of the messy lives of people, and sort of ideas themselves are not what necessarily drives the fiction. And I think he's saying that if you want big ideas, science fiction is the place to go in all the various types of literature.
I think there's a lot of truth in that, yeah. Particularly since our realistic fiction has increasingly concentrated on sort of dysfunctional urban lives and does not have a very broad canvas often anymore. But on the other hand, you take a book like 100 Years of Solitude and that thing is raging with ideas, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Really, you know, there's a lot of ideas in that book as well as just a fictional event.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a spectrum. But of course, you know, science fiction has always been, yeah, it's for geeks. We're all geeks that write science fiction.
So you are one yourself. You'll proudly claim that title.
Oh, man, I'm about the geekiest 15-year-old girl you ever saw. I'm no good at the science part of it. That is to say, the hard science. Anything that involves math, forget it. But I know my way around the social sciences, and of course that's what I use in my science fiction.
Mm-hmm. So what is it about science fiction, or include fantasy in there as well if you want, but what makes this type of writing so conducive to exploring big ideas?
I would limit that maybe to science fiction because there are fantasies a little bit different. The point of fantasy is invention rather than ideas often, I think.
Okay.
Whereas science fiction really doesn't. You know, a good science fiction novel often follows an idea through. It's the joy of the pursuit, isn't it? It's, you know, anybody likes to be able to follow an idea through. Take something like Philip Dick's Man in the High Castle, where the idea is simply that Germany and Japan won the Second World War. and America is an occupied country. Well, that's one of the ideas of the book. That's a sort of counter-history book. Part of the joy of reading that wonderful book is just the way he works it out. What would it be like if, you know? And somehow we all seem to enjoy doing that.
And many of us do speculate about those things in just our own lives, but we don't take the trouble to actually try to figure it out point by point. And it sounds like that's what you're saying. That's what a lot of science fiction writers do.
Yeah, I think it is, right.
Mm-hmm. So do you see your own science fiction work as a literature of ideas?
Some of it. Some of it I was, you know, pursuing a thought, sort of. Some of it is more like fantasy in the sense of it, I'm really just doing it for the pleasure of invention. Just the way a musician invents a tune and fleshes it out into a symphony or something. I invent a place or some people and make a world of them. And I get a lot of pleasure doing that, and apparently a lot of readers share the pleasure.
Now, the traditional rap against science fiction, at least among people who don't like it, is that it cares more about ideas and speculative worlds than about the quality of the writing itself. What do you make of that criticism?
Well, it was very largely true 30, 40 years ago. There was a certain refusal to write fine, to write very well, to write literarily among a great many science fiction writers, most of whom were men, many of whom were trained in engineering and similar fields. They didn't want all that frills and falderal. They just wanted to tell a story, which is kind of a myth. I mean, you can't just tell the story. But a lot of early science fiction was pretty crude. The continuing the idea that all science fiction is just ideas and it's badly written and all that, that simply comes from people who don't read it. I'm sorry, but a lot of people who say they don't like it, you ask, what have you read? And they haven't read any. Mm-hmm. And they say they don't like it. That's not fair.
Now, I know there are some people who are often pegged genre writers who kind of bristle at that word, and you know, they don't even like the sense that there are these different places in the bookstore. You know, there's the science fiction section and the crime section and the historical fiction section. You know, why can't it all just be shelved together? Are you one of those people, or do you kind of wear the science fiction label proudly?
That's an awful big question that involves a lot of my whole life. To be labeled a genre writer is, in the eyes of about 90% of readers, is to be labeled second rate. Face it. So obviously a lot of people bristle and say, well, all right, I'm a sci-fi writer and I'm proud of it, you know. I wish they'd forget the darn labels. A lot of my books are really not, they don't classify easily as sci-fi or, God help us, or even science fiction. They may be fantasy, but that may not be the important thing about them. These genre labels are marketing labels. They make it easy for readers who are addicted to a certain type of fiction to find it in the library or the bookstore. They make it real, real easy for the publisher to sell it. Otherwise, they are useless. And they can be very misleading when you get writers like me or like Michael Chabon, who is, you know, who just, I don't care what genre they say I'm writing in. I have this book I want to write. Now, Michael likes, he likes imitating and doing pastiche work too, which I don't do. But to call him a mystery writer because his last book is a mystery, you know, would be ridiculous. So I have to answer your question in general. I wish you'd just unstick the labels from me and just read the book, you know, and decide what it is yourself. Mm-hmm. But that's wishful thinking.
Ursula K. Le Guin is the award-winning author of short stories, essays, poetry, and novels. Her latest novel is called Lavinia. Le Guin spoke with Steve Paulson. According to Stephen King, Howard Phillips Lovecraft was the 20th century's greatest practitioner of the classic horror tale. But H.P. Lovecraft didn't just write horror. He also wrote fantasy and science fiction, or weird fiction, as it was called. Lovecraft wrote one of his most famous stories in 1926, The Call of Cthulhu. Here's an excerpt from Landfall Productions' audiobook version of this classic Lovecraft tale, narrated by Garrick Hagen.
Poor Johansson's handwriting almost gave out when he wrote of this. Of the six men who never reached the ship, he thinks two perished of pure fright in that accursed instant. The thing cannot be described. There is no language for such abysms of shrieking and immemorial lunacy, such eldritch contradictions of all matter, force, and cosmic order. A mountain walked or stumbled. God! What wonder that across the earth a great architect went mad, and poor Wilcox raved with fear in that telepathic instant. The thing of the idols, the green, sticky spawn of the stars, had awaked to claim his own. The stars were right again. And what an age-old cult had failed to do by design, a band of innocent sailors had done by accident. After vigintillions of years, great Cthulhu was loose again and ravening for delight. Three men were swept up by the flabby claws before anybody turned. God rest them, if there be any rest in the universe. They were Donovan, Guerrera, and Angstrom. Parker slipped as the other three were plunging frenziedly over endless vistas of green-crusted rock to the boat. And Johansson swears he was swallowed up by an angle of masonry which shouldn't have been there, an angle which was acute, but behaved as if it were obtuse. So only Bryden and Johansson reached the boat and pulled desperately for the alert as the mountainous monstrosity flopped down the slimy stones and hesitated, floundering at the edge of the water.
Garrick Hagen reading an excerpt from H.P. Lovecraft's story, The Call of Cthulhu. S.T. Joshi is probably the leading Lovecraft scholar. Joshi is the author of the acclaimed 700-page biography, H.P. Lovecraft, A Life.
Lovecraft always had a great interest in pure science. In fact, one of his earliest intellectual interests was chemistry. He started learning chemistry when he was about 8 years old. And also then about the age of 12, he became fascinated by astronomy. In fact, let me just quote you a very brief thing he said later about his interest in astronomy. He says, "The most poignant sensations of my existence are those of 1896, he was 6 years old, when I discovered the Hellenic world, he's referring to classical literature, and of 1902, when I discovered the myriad suns and worlds of infinite space. Sometimes I think the latter event the greater for the grandeur of that growing conception of the universe still excites a thrill hardly to be duplicated." Which shows you that what Lovecraft wanted to do was to expand the range of horror fiction to encompass not just our world, but the entire universe. And that's really a very science fictional point of view.
And that really became essential to everything that he wrote after a while, didn't it? It's not just fiction about science or fiction about horror. He had a kind of grand view. He was known for, what are they, the philosophy is called cosmicism.
He called it cosmicism, yes, the idea that human beings are insignificant in the vast realms of space and time. And that's why some of his greatest stories, like, say, At the Mountains of Madness or The Shadow Out of Time, present an enormous backdrop against which these pathetically insignificant human beings, you know, function as if they were ants upon a vast stage. And Lovecraft created these cosmic monsters, which are really symbols for the extent to which we don't know about the universe. They come from the depths of space and have accidental relations with human beings and, again, basically cast us aside as if we were mere ants.
It's astonishing that people like these so much, isn't it? It doesn't sound as though it's a very encouraging philosophy.
Well, I'll tell you, Lovecraft had a pretty bleak view of life, at least in an abstract sense. He himself, I think, was actually a fairly well-adjusted individual. Some people think he was, you know, eccentric, and of course we all have our eccentricities, but his view is somewhat bleak, perhaps. But what I think fascinates readers is, A, his prose style, which is very evocative. I mean, some people think it's overblown, you know, rhetorical, flamboyant, but I think it works for the type of fiction he was writing. And this idea of an entire universe of horror in which one story builds upon another. They almost become chapters of a novel, of an immense novel that he wrote. Of course, we now refer to this mythology that he created as the Cthulhu mythos. He never called it that, incidentally, and he never, I don't know that he put as much weight upon it as many other people do. But to be sure, a lot of his stories sort of build upon each other, and they cease to be individual units and become more than the sum of their parts.
I'm curious about the basis of it, though, this cosmicism. It sounds as though he's a kind of nihilist. He doesn't believe that there's a future for humans.
That's true enough. I think that that's a fair statement. But again, Lovecraft did say that things are important to humans on the human scale, and that's perfectly acceptable. He himself had pretty pronounced views about certain issues, whether it be political or social, but he realized that those are purely human, that we simply don't matter in the cosmos. In fact, I'll quote you another little famous statement that he wrote when he submitted his first major story on this subject called The Call of Cthulhu to Weird Tales magazine, and he expresses this idea exactly. He wrote a letter to the editor explaining sort of what this story is about, and he says, "Now all my tales are based on the fundamental premise that common human laws and interests and emotions have no validity or significance in the vast cosmos at large. To achieve the essence of real externality, whether of time or space or dimension, one must forget that such things as organic life, good and evil, love and hate, and all such local attributes of a negligible and temporary race called mankind have any existence at all."
Wow.
A breathtaking statement, really.
Yeah.
I mean, basically what Lovecraft is doing is contradicting, in a sense, the entire basis of our moral and ethical life. He referred to it elsewhere as a cosmic-centered fiction as opposed to humano-centered fiction. So many other writers, and indeed so many other religions and philosophies, are focused on the human. Humanity is the aim and end of everything. Lovecraft says, no, human beings are just a little speck in the cosmos. There's so much out there that has nothing to do with us.
This is one of Lovecraft's best-known stories, isn't it? It's from the mid-20s sometime?
Yes, The Call of Cthulhu, 1926.
And it is the basis, I gather, of the whole Lovecraft mythos. This is a more overt explanation of things that he sort of referred to in other stories?
This is basically the initial story he wrote that laid the groundwork for that mythos, yes. But Lovecraft never stuck to a preconceived plan. He didn't sit down and say, okay, this is the Cthulhu mythos, I'm going to write this from now on. Each story built upon it, to be sure, but always with variations, and he never felt bound to what he said before. This mythos developed sort of haphazardly, really, in his life. And remember, he said that all my tales, whether part of that mythos or not, have this philosophical point of view.
Yeah. Tell me about the character. You're saying Cthulhu. It's spelled Cthulhu?
Yes. Lovecraft, I think, had a little fun trying to bamboozle people as to how to pronounce that word or name. C-T-H-U-L-H-U. It looks as if it should be pronounced Cthulhu, but he maintained in a letter written much later that it's really two syllables, and the first one is sort of coughed or barked out. I think he was just having a little fun. So it's Cthulhu, supposedly.
Cthulhu is, in fact, an alien entity that is here and threatening us even if we don't know exactly where it is.
In this particular story, the idea is that Cthulhu and his minions, whoever they may be, Star Spawn, as Lovecraft calls them in the story, came to Earth millions and millions of years ago, established or built an enormous city called Rylye. Actually, I don't even know how to pronounce that. R-apostrophe-L-Y-E-H. But anyway, they built this city, and then it plunged underwater. So it's lying underwater in the Pacific Ocean and has been there for millions of years, and Cthulhu is accidentally trapped there. And this story talks about an earthquake that unwittingly brings that city up to the surface just for, you know, a few hours or maybe a few days, and what happens when some sailors encounter that entity, but then it plunges back into the ocean again.
That's the only story in which Clulu actually appears, isn't it?
It is indeed. Lovecraft refers to him or it, a lot in other stories, but Clulu never takes the stage in any other tale.
We have this one story in which Clulu appears. What does he, it, she look like?
Well, mostly a massive sort of green protoplasm, apparently. And the ingenious thing is that as these sailors encounter this enormous monster, in fact, Lovecraft refers to it as a mountain walked or stumbled, incredible sentence there, they realize they can't escape from it. So they try to drive their ship right into it, and they do so, and it breaks up, but then it recombines. And what Lovecraft is saying is this entity is made up of different type of matter than we recognize as organic matter. And that was an ingenious way of getting that point across.
Mm. There's a kind of ironic reference in the beginning of that story that he says, I think that's the one in which he says that we live on a placid island of ignorance in the midst of black seas of infinity.
Yes, a spectacular idea.
Yeah, and there you are with this island out there in the Pacific somewhere with the horror of infinity waiting for you. And it suggests that there are things we're not supposed to know.
That's right. Some people think Lovecraft had a fear of science. It wasn't that exactly. He was fascinated by any developments of science. And in his lifetime, he kept up on all kinds of scientific discoveries. In fact, he was thrilled when we believed we found the new planet Pluto. I believe maybe that's not a planet after all, but nevertheless, Lovecraft realized that was only the third planet in the solar system that had been discovered since, you know, classical antiquity. And he immediately wrote the story, The Whisperer in Darkness, based upon this idea, and he called it Yuggoth, of course. So he was interested in science, but I think he was skeptical of our ability to cope with scientific discoveries, especially those types of discoveries that reduce our inflated self-importance in the universe.
Mm-hmm. It's similar to what other people have written about our discovery of nuclear weaponry, that was one of those things we weren't supposed to discover, how to split the atom. Mm-hmm. Lovecraft might have had the same notion about that had he lived.
On that point, there's this great story, The Color Out of Space, which Edmund Wilson, the critic, who generally took a rather dim view of Lovecraft, praised because Wilson felt that it anticipated the effects of atomic radiation. Now, I think that was sort of accidental, because what happens in this story is a meteorite comes down, lands on a remote farm in Massachusetts, and to be sure, eventually everything turns gray. Not only the field, the grass, but also human beings and animals, they turn gray and crumble into dust. A fascinating and horrific conception, which I suppose does anticipate the idea of atomic radiation.
Do you think that he's had an impact on modern writers of science fiction and horror?
Oh, his impact is enormous. I mean, you can't go anywhere nowadays without some kind of allusion to Lovecraft. And the science fiction, I'll tell you, it's very interesting. The science fiction writers of an earlier generation express a certain hostility to Lovecraft. You'll find Isaac Asimov, for example, saying some very unkind things about Lovecraft. Avram Davidson, too. I think it's because they didn't like the fact that Lovecraft was melding horror with science fiction. For them, science fiction was a pure, clean genre that sought to really extol human triumph over the cosmos. That was basically the vein of the science fiction of the Golden Age. And of course, Lovecraft was entirely contradictory to that. And I think they took umbrage at the fact that Lovecraft is using science to sort of pervert their own point of view. But as things went on, as science fiction itself became darker with the work of people like William Gibson and even Thomas Pynchon, for example, who's actually an admirer of Lovecraft, you can tell, Lovecraft became more accepted in the science fiction community. He's always been accepted in the horror community. I mean, people like Stephen King have expressed the greatest admiration for Lovecraft and have imitated Lovecraft in several of their works.
S.J. Joshi is the author of H.P. Lovecraft, A Life. With At the Mountains of Madness. What do you think of H.P. Lovecraft's literary philosophy of cosmicism? The idea that there is no recognizable divine presence and that humans are insignificant in the grand scheme of things. You can let us know by sending us email through our website at ttbook.org. Coming up, we'll conclude our Hour of the Philosophy of Science Fiction. I'm Jim Fleming. It's To the Best of Our Knowledge from PRI, Public Radio International. István Csicseri Rónai Jr. is an English professor at DePauw University, where he teaches world literature and science fiction courses. He's also the author of The Seven Beauties of Science Fiction. Csicseri Rónai told Anne Strainchamps about the title of his book.
It's kind of a crazy title. It has its own little kind of shock value. The Seven Beauties is actually based on a mystical medieval Persian poem with that title, Seven Beauties, about a king who marries seven queens, essentially, from the known parts of the world, and he builds seven halls in a palace for them, and they tell him seven stories that coalesce into a kind of mystical moral tale, and each one of the stories contains all of the other stories. So I chose that title because most of the critical work on science fiction has been pretty rationalistic and critical-minded, and usually about how science fiction either critiques reality or can be used to critique reality. And I really wanted to focus on science fiction as a kind of imagining, as a way we now imagine art and even beauty in a world that's saturated by technology. So I decided, since science fiction itself is a kind of oxymoron, that's what it was intended to be. So you have science, you could put a slash between science and fiction. I thought I'd sort of add another one and take a title from a mystical poem and see how that works with the genre.
Hmm. Well, we don't have time to get to all seven, but maybe we could talk about some of the different beauties of science fiction that you identified. What about the second one, fictive novums? What are fictive novums?
Well, the novum is a concept that's kind of dear to science fiction scholarship. It was introduced in the scholarship by the great theorist of science fiction, Darko Suvin, in the book Metamorphoses of Science Fiction. And he took it from a great mystical Marxist philosopher, German philosopher, Ernst Bloch, for whom the novum, which means the new thing in Latin, the novum is a moment of newness in history where people perceive that something new has occurred, and it allows people to become aware that history isn't just one damn thing after another, but there are actually new things can be made, and so it gives them a sense of freedom. Suvin sort of turns this into a literary category and argues that a novum is that innovation, that discovery or invention or new social arrangement around which the action of a science fiction novel sort of organizes itself. So there's always something new. It could be, a discovery of an alien being like in the Alien films, or an invention, a mega computer, or a social arrangement like the totalitarian government of 1984. And then all of the action then sort of is logically organized around that. So the novum in science fiction is a fictive version, so an imaginary version of what the philosopher Bloch considered to be actually a real phenomenon in the world.
So examples in film, for instance, of fictive novums, E.T. comes to mind.
Yes.
You know, this flying saucer has landed.
Right.
E.T. is found in a child's bedroom.
And everyone has to reorganize their sense of reality around this new information, or probably the sort of quintessential novum from film would be the monolith from 2001, which not only forces the actors in the film or the characters in the film to organize their entire reality around them, but the entire human race has to change to adapt to it.
What about in terms of writers? You write that the great writer of fictive novums was Philip K. Dick.
I should say that all science fiction writers use fictive novums. They can't actually write science fiction without it because there wouldn't be something new that would instigate the action. Otherwise, it would be realism describing a world that we're familiar with. The thing about Dick is that he actually includes many novums. The classical view about novums in science fiction is that there's usually just one. You have one very dramatic change in the world, and that sets the theme for the rest. But Dick always includes several, and they don't evolve from the same historical paths. They seem to all have evolved from their own particular paths.
What's an example?
Well, some of them could be gigantic, world-changing novums, like in The Three Stigmata of Palmer Eldritch. There's a drug that Martian colonists take, and after they take it, they are absorbed into the body of this alien godlike being. Or the very famous example from Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, on which the movie Blade Runner was based, of having artificial human beings that are almost indistinguishable from human beings, but really are different. But then he has sort of micro-novums, little novums, like psychiatrists in a suitcase, or talking refrigerators, or talking taxicabs, or intelligent slime molds, or mutant rats that play music on nose flutes. And the effect of all of this is quite amazing because, well, Dick sort of matured in the psychedelic culture of the Bay Area around San Francisco. So he's kind of culturally devoted to this concept of sort of delirium, that there's lots of different things that sort of surprise us in reality, and new reality surprises.
Yeah, I was going to say this sounds like the acid trip school of
yes,
science fiction.
Yeah, it's you could say that, but it has another side to it in that these little novums, they seem to be kind of a promise that technology will give us new companions. They're usually friendly, or at least not hostile, particularly when you look at these gigantic and sort of catastrophic novums that occur on a large scale in his work. We grow to kind of depend on these little companions.
You also write about the third beauty of science fiction, and this one you call future history. What's future history?
Well, this is also something that's been part of science fiction from the beginning. It's simply imagining our future, or our history rather, moving off into the future, or rather the many potential paths that it might take. Again, science fiction is specifically about how history might be changed by a new thing that technology or science or social science might bring or illuminate. So when we read science fiction, I think this is one of its main attractions, we have this feeling that history is not predetermined, that there are many possible futures. And that also affects our sense of the past. More and more science fiction writers are writing either alternative histories or some form of fantasy on the past that makes us feel like perhaps even our sense of the past is being determined, and determined in a way that it created us, then maybe that's also something that should be destabilized.
Well, in fact, isn't there a growing subgenre, very popular subgenre of science fiction now called steampunk?
Yes, steampunk is, it's very popular. My son, who is a kind of goth techno computer scientist in the Bay Area, is devoted to this style. Steampunk actually came out of the dominant subgenre of science fiction in the 1980s and 1990s, which was cyberpunk. And essentially, steampunk writers will imagine a world in which an anachronistic technology, relatively modern technology, has been implanted into the past. And so it changes the past into a kind of alternative past.
So it's sort of, say, a novel set in Victorian England, except everybody's doing amazing things with computers.
Right. It doesn't have to be computers. It can be, it could simply be a spaceship. It allows for a lot of fantastic play. It's also a kind of metafiction. These steampunk works are usually set in early phases of the Industrial Revolution. So they're kind of meditations on the origin of technology, but simultaneously they're meditations on the origin of science fiction.
Hmm. Is there an example you could give?
Well, I think the quintessential work, maybe not the best, but the most interesting, is The Difference Engine, which was co-written by William Gibson and Bruce Sterling, who were the dominant figures of the cyberpunk movement. That imagines a Victorian England, essentially using the language of Dickens and Disraeli, in which Charles Babbage's difference engines are the ideal prototype of the computer, which never actually was put into operation. They imagine the world in which that difference engine was put into operation. So it's as if artificial intelligence were working not in contemporary United States, but in mid-19th century England.
Where do you see science fiction going in the future?
Well,
boy, that's a science fiction-y sort of question, isn't
well,
it?
Well, I'm not even sure that is, because clearly we don't know. I would say there'll always be some science fiction that resembles the work of Jules Verne and H.G. Wells and just about every science fiction writer that's contributed to the genre. But also, we have no idea what new kinds of interests and technologies and cultures there are going to be. So I think there'll be science fiction of some kind always, as long as technology pervades everyday life. But as I write at the conclusion of my book, there may come a time when we're kind of exhausted by our technology. We're no longer as interested in it. We don't believe that it will solve problems or satisfy desires that emerge. So I don't think that the technological base for it will ever cease, but we just may lose interest in it.
István Csicseri Rónai Jr. is the author of The Seven Beauties of Science Fiction. He spoke with Anne Strainchamps. It's To the Best of Our Knowledge. I'm Jim Fleming. If you'd like a copy of this hour, you can call the radio store at 1-800-747-7444 and ask for program number 1123A, The Future of Science Fiction. If you have questions or comments about the program, you can send us email through our website at ttbook.org. To the Best of Our Knowledge is produced at Wisconsin Public Radio. This program was produced by Doug Gordon, with help from Mary Lou Finnegan, Anne Strainchamps, Charles Monroe Kane, and Veronica Rickard. Our executive producer is Steve Paulson. Our technical director is Kirill Owen. You can stream To the Best of Our Knowledge on our website at ttbook.org, where you will also find a link to the weekly podcast.
PRI, Public Radio International.